today I will give a short talk on seasonal rainfall forecast, which is the project I just finished and submit the draft final report to the register. I just show you this. This is the weather map from the Thai meteorological department of DT this morning. So you see, this is what we call monsoon trough. This is the band that we have everywhere here. It's a band of cloud and heavy rain. This morning we have a low pressure center located over northeast Thailand and another one in the Bay of Bengal. And over the northern Thailand we have high pressure coming. So it's dry and cold, but not that cold. It's also starting to approach winter in Thailand. Another website that is I want to show is the satellite image from Japan. Yeah, this is the last one will be this morning. This is the tropical cyclone that made landfall in northern Vietnam and just dissipated because of the intrusion of cold and dry air. This is how we do the weather forecast. We look at the weather map showing the surface pressure, temperature, and other things, and also the upper level. So the satellite image. But to make a seasonal forecast, we cannot use this kind of data.
Forecast, right, in Thailand, but they also have a company that do the season.
few years, they beat the Indian meteorological forecast. That will also happen in some other developing countries. But today, the official forecast is better than the private forecast for the first time. Okay, they use statistical method, but different model. Another method is what we call dynamical forecast, where they can do the climate change forecast and also can do the seasonal forecast. But this model is very complicated and require very high performance computer, or we call it supercomputer. So if you look at the top 500 supercomputer in the world, about half of the top 10 supercomputer will be used for weather and climate forecast, and about another half is for military, like nuclear weapon or energy, nuclear simulation, something like that. So in Thailand, we have this model, but just for daily weather forecast. The computer is not big enough, not fast enough. So in developing country, they don't have capability to do the climate forecast by global climate model. We have to base on the other center, like from US, European, and or Japan, or even China. The third method is the combination of the statistical method and analytical method. We call the hybrid method. What I'm going to do today is just show you that I use the hybrid method to do the seasonal rainfall forecast for Thailand. And this is my topic. This is based on the report I presented to DIF about a few months ago. The objective of this project is just the development program for this seasonal rainfall forecast for Thailand. The technique that I use is called the dark scaling. But there are so many methods for dark scaling. What I use is called analog dark scaling. And if you do the forecast for a really long time, you have a prediction that your forecast will be wrong, because there are infinitely many possibilities to happen in the forecast. You start it with one observation or one initial data, you end up with only one forecast. To correct this, not correct, just to improve the forecast, what we do is that we do the forecast for the same day, but starting from different initial conditions. Okay? That's called ensemble forecast. Why developing country still cannot run the model for the dynamical forecast? Other developed country, most of the developed country, they do the ensemble forecast. This means that there are big gap between seasonal forecast among this developing country. So I said this about, I think about 25 years ago too, when I was working in TMD. I told them that one day we have to buy the forecast from other countries. And this happened right now. The European Center for Medium and Weather Forecast are offering weather forecast for any country with a price, depend on the output of the model that you want to use. And Vietnam already signed the contract to buy this weather forecast. Why in Thailand they are not interested? So this already happened. And if you ever look at the software for the mobile phone, you can see that there are a lot of weather forecasts on there. So what I am doing, this is not just to be the best in the world, but just try to apply the technique to the seasonal rainfall forecast. And this technique is not this has not been used before, the combination of scaling and analog and ensemble forecast. So my team is from T&D, okay? They are directors of some division, okay? This is for convenience to get the data without buying it analog. Okay? So this is the analog data scaling. The concept is if you forecast if you make a forecast for a few days in the future, rainfall is very difficult to get an accurate forecast because rainfall is what we call a discrete quantity. It's happened and then some. It's not like temperature or humidity that is continuous variable. But rainfall is it has a lot of variability in terms of quantity and also timing, also the area. So it's very difficult. So the global climate model cannot predict rainfall very well. We have to advance statistical method to improve the forecast from the global climate model. So the concept of analog forecast is to use the large scale weather forecast like temperature, humidity, wind, okay, and then try to find the day that we have, the day in the past that we have similar pattern of parameter. Okay. And if we find that day, we call it analog day. And then we use rainfall for that analog day to be the forecast of rainfall in the future day. This is a simple, this concept is not new. It has been used but manually for more than 50 years. Okay. But today we have a computer that is not expensive, so we can apply this concept using computer. So I got the forecast from the climate model from National Center for Environmental Prediction, or ENSEMBLE. And this is called ENSEMBLE Climate Forecast System or something. And this is the system that can do the forecast up to 9 months in advance. Okay. The parameter I select are the predictors that I use for the downscale or for the analog forecast is the incidental ratio, temperature, humidity, and wind at 50 hectopascal is about 1.5 kilometers from the surface of the Earth. And this is the forecast. We need the data in the past, so I use the data from ensemble climate forecast system also, but this is the archive of climatological data. Okay. So we use the forecast for CASV2 and find the analog day from CFSSR. Why I don't use the Thai data? Because Thailand climatological data only cover Thailand. So in this method, you have to look for the pattern that cover not only Thailand but the surrounding area also. So I have to use the global climate data. Okay. Now, if you find the analog day, we don't use the rainfall from the climate model because the rainfall from climate model is has a poor accuracy. So I use the real observed rainfall from Thai Meteorological Department. So from the global model, I can zoom in at the rainfall of the station. So this is some kind of downscaling, so I call it analog downscaling. Okay. The problem is that in Thailand, there are a lot of missing data, so I cannot use the whole data, the whole 100 station. I have to select only one only some sessions that have a complete record for at least 30 years. Okay, as I said before, we have the ensemble forecast system there. This is for the climatology data or the data in the past. It is one of the most reliable global climate data set. And they have the tide resolution 4 times per day. Okay, and the resolution is about 50 to 50 kilometers. The data is from 1979 to 2010. Okay, and another one. This is the climatological data. It is the forecast data. It has better resolution. Okay, about 27 kilometers, but we have to use the same resolution. I have to use the same resolution for the climatological data so that I can compare it. Okay. And it includes, this model include atmosphere, land, ocean, and even deep in the soil. So it's a complete climatological climate model. Okay. And do the forecast, the model forecast for 9 months every 5 days. And in 1 day we run the forecast for 4 times, every 6 hours. Okay. So we can see that a lot of information is available. It's available online. But the problem is to download it, you need a really fast internet. So I spent, this project is about 2 years. I spent about 15 months to get the data, the complete data, okay? And unfortunately, KUTT internet is very frequently, I mean, just disconnected. So it's a problem. And this channel is about 100 kilometers. And this is the TNT rain station. The complete 30-year record, we have about 50 stations. So it's not complete, the 30-year rainfall data. We have about 80 stations that cover the 30-year period, but only 30 stations that have a particular, no gap in the data. So how to compare the similarity between the forecast day and the day in the past? This is one method. This is the method I use. Is just look at the forecast M is the predictor. M can be temperature, humidity, pressure, and so on. You look at the forecast and also the climatological data and you find the difference. Okay. And you do this for every point in your domain. So this is this is today, T is today. This is, suppose I forecast for, let's say, 1st January 2016, and then I have to look at the 1st January of the previous 30 years. So for every point in the domain. This is 1 day comparison. And I also use the yesterday comparison. Okay, so I use 2 days. But in fact, this can be 7 o'clock in the morning, and this can be go back 6 hours. So delta T doesn't have to be 1 day. It can be 2 days, 6 hours, whatsoever you want. But in this formula, I use every 6 hours. So I forecast, I use a forecast that provide for every 6 hours. So in 1 day forecast, we have four forecasts for that. And we use all those four. It's a subtype of ensemble. Based on this formula, this is an example of the forecast. I use the past data, okay? I forecast the moisture, temperature as to June 1st, 2010. And I look back to the aerodynamical data, 30 years, and I found that the base match is this day, June 1st, 1992. So this is a similar, we have similar pattern and similar maximum or minimum pattern. So if you want to have a better analog day, you have to go back further, more than 30 years. So this is an analog day. So to forecast the rainfall for June 1st, 2010, I use the rainfall from June 1st, 1992. But the rain is come from TMD station, not from the climatological data of CFS. So it means that we use large scale from climate model, and then the rain that you want to forecast or you want to downscale come from the station of TMD. So by this case, we downscale the 50 or 100 by 100 resolution forecast to the resolution of the station, which is usually about 50 kilometers or less. So that is just one day forecast. And then I said the forecast, suppose this is the initial condition and this is the forecast. Let's say after 3 months, so the real world or the truth is just this one. These ellipses represent error or possibility that the data can be. There is an error in initial condition or observation because of instrument error or transmission error or everything. So what you observe is not, cannot be real, it's just one possible initial condition. So if you use this initial condition, you end up with this forecast. If you use this, you end up with this. And you will never know what will be the real. Because in this case, the truth is that this one. The truth is not accurately observed. So you cannot get the accurate forecast because your initial condition is already wrong. So what we do, what we call ensemble forecast, is that we use several initial conditions to generate several forecasts and find the statistical values or statistical mean or deviation or several probability. So today the forecast, ensemble forecast is done for seasonal forecast in several countries. They use 50 initial conditions. So we call, they have 50 members. Imagine that one forecast for 1 day is take about 30 minutes, okay, in Thailand. Okay. So if you do the forecast for 9 months, that's just one initial condition. But they use 50 initial conditions. Imagine how fast the computer has to be, and how big the memory they have to be. So it's beyond our economy to buy that kind of computer. So I use this, and then I do the forecast for the summer monsoon from 15 May to 15 October of not called the forecast, but it's just my simulation because it's already happened. October 2010, I use initial condition from 1st to 31st January of the same year. So it means that I forecast from this one is about 9 months. And use observation from TMD 30 rain station. And this is
the output.
I do this for 30 stations. I show you one good forecast and one bad forecast. This is at Lampang. The summer rainfall for 2010, the observation is 735.5 millimeter, and this is a normal year based on 30 year statistic. So you can see that this is the This is the forecast for different predictor. If you use pressure, you come up with this. This is the amount of rainfall classified into interval. Each interval is about 100 millimeter apart, and this is the this is the probability. You can see that pressure here, red. If you use moisture, the forecast will be blue. If you use temperature, it will be gray. And if you use the open potential, which is related to wind, it will be yellow. You can see that different predictor give you different forecasts. But if you combine this, this is a combination of four predictors, you come up with this one. And in this case, the forecast is correct because the observed is 725, and the forecast is about between 700 to 800. So it's okay, correct. But look at this one. This is Phuket. This is the very wet year for Phuket. The amount of rainfall is almost 2,000 here. But the forecast, the most the highest probability is just a few hundred. So in this case, the forecast is wrong, totally wrong. Okay. In addition, you can see that the distribution of forecast, in this case, is very wide. Okay. From a few hundred to several thousand millimeter. But in the case of Lampang, the forecast is has less deviation. So we can see that for this year, the forecast for Phuket is very poor, but for Lampang it's good. I think that because this can happen because the global owner did not see Phuket. Global model is the resolution is very. Very large, about let's say 100 by 100. Okay, but Phuket is smaller. It's not on the midpoint of the model. So actually, in the model didn't see Phuket, but see ocean. So it's starting with wrong input. So you come up with this one. So I can see that there is a. A weak point or disadvantage, obviously, the global climate model is that you can see a very small area. And for the correlation, if you look at all the stations, 30 stations, and use look at the forecast, the correlation of forecast and the observed rain, if you use mean sea level pressure, the correlation is about 0.7. If you use moisture, it's about 0.6, temperature about 0.8, and geopotential is about 0.8. So in practice, the forecast that is that has the high, that has the correlation better than 0.6, is acceptable. Okay, so in this case, it's all acceptable. But if you combine all the forecasts from several, from various predictors, you come up with little bit better correlation. This is a 30 station forecast. This is the amount of rainfall of the observation, and this is the amount of rainfall from the forecast. This is just a scatter plot, and you come up with the correlation as high as 0.06. Okay. But this look good, but practically it's very useful. Practical use of farmer because this is for the whole country. It's still very good. But if you suppose you are in Phuket, it's totally wrong. So this is how you interpret the results that is going. It's still very good, but if you look at this, it's not applicable. Anyway, from this I have learned that most of the seasonal forecast by this method underestimating observation. So if I classify the rainfall into normal year based on 30-year record, normal year is represented by zero, the dry year represented by negative, and the wet year by positive. During the about 30 years of the simulation, there are 8 years that are normal. The forecast come out with 6. There are 7 years with a dry condition. The forecast is 22 years. So it's like this. So you can see that he is underestimated before the observation, especially when it is a dry year, let's say for example. When it is a wet year. So in this case, the rainfall is above normal, but the forecast come up with only 2 years. Anyway, this is just the first step. We have to do a lot to improve this, but there is a good potential to further develop this. And TIF has asked me to develop this further with a separate project, but they still does not give the funding, so it's just an idea. In this case, the new project, I have to work with the user right there, with the social department or Ministry of Agriculture, so that I can identify what exactly the type of the presentation of the forecast, what the user wants. And I have the idea for future work. The work that I have been done is just find the analog for the same day. Let's say I forecast for 1st June this year, I look at 1st June of the previous 30 years. So I plan to do this, and comparison should be not only one day. Let's say 1st June forecast should be compared to 1st, 2nd, 3rd June, and also 30th of May, something like that. Okay. So you have more climatological data to search for analog data. You will get better analog data, and the result of the program should be better. And the weak point of this Dusadee method is you cannot forecast the extreme value. You can be forecast well for the normal value. So I think we have to apply statistical technique for extreme forecast in the future of this. Okay. Thank you.
A lot of
book is a lot of time is spent in searching there. We have a huge database. And, suppose I start with the initial condition on 1st of January. Okay, I have 8 forecasts to search for analog. So I have 8 analog day. And then go on until 31st of January. So a lot of analog days. And then all these analog days, I select only one. So.
And you use the minimum?
This formula.
Minimum distance.
Find the minimum D.
Okay.
Another improvement can be changing the what you call this now, how to find the minimum distance. This is just a simple technique that a lot of complicated technique that should provide a better focus. But this project is to prove the idea that analog dust scaling is practical.
I have the last question, which is this formula. Well, I think it is, I'm not sure how you handle inconsistent dimensions of variables. Have you considered normalization in this?
I didn't do any QC because all the model output from the pathology computer is already QC and just use as it is. I don't adjust anything.
The units, suppose that you have, since you have a temperature, BNC level, and the same
each parameter is just compared among itself.
Okay.
But each parameter, each predictor will provide you provide different kind of things. And that is another ensemble.
I don't have my understanding is or not that your forecast the day on the positive. And this is just like to prove
yes. Yes. Because I cannot use a real forecast because I have to wait another 5 months. So there are a lot of questions that has to be answered. accept this this look good, this particular simulation, but I'm afraid if I change it again, maybe it's not good. Yeah. Anyways, this is a concept.
Those who would like to the price has changed at X Village, and I would like to acknowledge the researcher who have their research project in the hands of the professor, so that he's getting the award from who's doing what. Okay, thank you very much for today. Shall we give our